when one of my gaming systems spectacularly failed, dumping water down the entire rest of the rack, the most expensive piece of equipment I lost was this battery backup. Now, the obvious thing to do when a piece of high-voltage electrical equipment gets doused in water would be to buy a new one. But I have a better plan. You see, battery backups are expensive. And one of the most important parts, the lead-acid batteries, seem to be working just fine. No, that isn't how I checked them. To eBay I went, and while I could have bought a lightly used unit sans battery, it was this shipping damaged one that caught my eye. Hey, Tynan, have a look at what we're gonna be working on today.
Oh boy.
Specifically, it is thousands of dollars worth of shipping damage. I got this unit for just 500 bucks, meaning that it could very well be worth the time-consuming, not to mention dangerous process of transplanting the hopefully working internals from the shipping damaged unit into the, probably still good steel chassis of the original one.
So we can hope.
That's why I brought Tynan. He's gonna help make sure that I don't die today.
Are you tired of your ugly whip? Well, I am.
Excuse me, what are you doing?
Now you can enter the Rich Swift Stakes to win a Hennessy Velociraptor 600. A gold-plated Cybertruck or $100,000 cash.
Don't smash the car yet. Smash the link in the description.
From my point of view, there's two options. We can look at the original unit and try and diagnose what exactly in it may or may not be dead. Or we can look at the new unit, which I have about 12 days to inform the seller if it doesn't work, and we can determine if we think there's even a chance that transplanting those parts in here is going to make this fully functional.
Let's open up the shipping damaged one.
If only there was some way to remove these fasteners.
Like a screwdriver from lttstore.com?
Now, I have to confess to you, I did something bad. I did open up the original one to have a look at it. I didn't touch anything, which is very important because more than anything else we've ever done, folks, do not try this at home. This is high voltage, high current electrical equipment. There are capacitors in here that if you touch them, you will die.
And the batteries, that too.
I fooled around with the batteries too. That's why I'm pretty sure that they're working, but if you wanted to validate that for me, then that would probably be really good. Tynan's background is, what are you, like mechatronics? Like
mechatronics engineering.
Yeah, so some mechanical, some electronics.
Oh, yeah. Grief.
Lead acid batteries. He told me when he came in today that he was worried we might be doing the lithium ion one. I was like, no. I know much better than to fool around with any lithium ion battery. This.
196 volts.
It's pretty clear that some of these boards did get a little bit roughhoused in shipping, like this one.
Yeah, that looks very destroyed.
I've seen so much worse than this. The outside is really bad, and you can tell this thing took some bangs.
Yeah.
But like,
most of it looks fine.
What's safe to touch? Like these wires for sure.
Yeah.
This shroud, probably, maybe, depending what's under it.
Everything's probably safe, but we'll double check. Boards designed like this should have bleed resistors on any of the big capacitors, so they should discharge in a safe time. But you don't want to assume that.
Right. How do we check?
Looks like there's a whole bunch of touch points on a lot of the main traces that should be able to be measured.
Before you get to probulating though, should we change gears and have a look at the water damaged one to see if there's any clues as to what we may or may not need to salvage?
For sure.
This could be good because what's missing from the shipping damaged one is all of the boards associated with the interface and the display, which, I mean, clearly didn't get at least much water on it. Does anything jump out at you immediately here?
It's really dusty.
We moved all the equipment in while the house was kind of still a construction zone. That's on me. I think I noticed something. The new one is Rev03, and the original one is Rev00P. See, even when you revise a product, that doesn't mean that you revise every component of the product. They may be completely intercompatible, other than they had to change a supplier for a part, and they just revved it so that they could keep track of that.
In terms of immediate water damage things, the circuit breakers obviously got dunked on, so that may be a problem.
Tell me this, what would be your methodical way to approach something like this? Would you replace one part and try to fire it up? Or would you just go wholesale, complete change out, and then hope for the best?
Depends on how much time we have. Probably first thing is figuring out if there's anything obvious that's not connected that's supposed to be.
Everything should be connected. I haven't actually touched anything in here because I knew that I was out of my depth.
Yeah, I more meant like shorts or disconnects.
Oh, sure. Other possible spots are over the fan here. In fact, you can see where the water drips were coming through here. There are no holes
over here,
conveniently, over this board.
Which is good.
These holes are obviously
the relay,
or right
the
there.
Breaker.
And then there were also holes here. What's this?
That's a plug. That should not be a problem.
Okay. And then these holes were over the battery compartment, which survived and is now completely dry. This happened over a month ago now, and it seems fine.
I don't think the breakers are damaged to the point where it would matter.
Oh, really?
Because either they're connected or they're not connected, and they're connected.
Oh, balls.
It's probably not going to be an easy fix. There's a chance that there's like some of the fuses for the inputs blue, or
okay,
maybe some of the control board or what looks like a control board back here fried.
Uh-huh.
Oh.
Oh. Oh.
Oh.
Oh. Could this be as simple as a safety feature working for safety and our fuse blue?
Quite possibly.
Hey, blown fuses. We know this because we're getting a continuity beep on the shipping damaged unit, and we are not getting a continuity beep on these units.
This is input from the batteries to the inverter.
Mm-hmm.
This looks like it might be the ground return, maybe? No, what is that for?
What I'm gathering is you don't want to just put the new fuses in because then we don't have backup fuses if they blow.
Depends on how dangerous you want to live, because we have one attempt at these fuses not blowing again.
Right.
We should probably take these out of the chassis.
Okay, I can do that.
Cool, I'll do that one. One of the things I am concerned about for this is the second board underneath, which may have been water damaged more than we can see here. And this other fuse looks like it goes straight down. Whenever you're looking at an electrical system like this, for capacitors, you want to look for anything that's 50 volts rated or higher. I would recommend checking everything, but those are the ones you really want to look for.
275. So we want to check the
big.
Oh, I didn't even see that one.
Big. And then you want to see, look for the two sides of the capacitor. In this case, there's a whole bunch of vias around on these traces. So you can just find traces on both sides, probe across it, and you just want to see that it's zero or close to zero.
Now, I noticed you have this set to volts DC, but this says it's rated for 275 volts AC.
Yeah, capacitors are rated differently for AC versus DC depending on the type, but when you're trying to make sure something's de-energized, you want to measure DC, because AC can't exist when it's unplugged.
I'm excited. They never let me play with stuff like this.
That's why I'm here.
My only thing is that if I ever die on camera, I expect the company to monetize it. Get that cheddar. I know it doesn't matter because they design around it, but it always sketches me out when you screw a metal screw with a metal washer directly onto a PCB. I just don't like it.
Well, that's probably a good thing. They can cause fires sometimes. While I was doing some research for this shoot, I found a nice Eaton handbook that I found extraordinarily entertaining.
Oh?
Super professional.
Oh my God, that's
Professor
so cute.
Watson.
I love him.
The particular page that really got me was this one. 9 ways beer and UPSs are alike.
Okay. Here she comes.
Oh, perfect. I can look at that now. Oh, okay, I'm not gonna break anything.
Woo! Nice solder job, Eaton. That's quality.
Didn't realize these were pass-throughs to the
bottom. Yeah, it took me a minute to figure that out too. They go into what look like gigantic, chonky ground planes.
They're essentially bus bars between the boards. So that's how they're getting lots of power in between the two boards without having to run wires.
It's kind of funky though that they just use giant standoffs. I mean, metal's metal.
Yeah.
And if it's metal, then it's metal, but like.
Yeah. And they're brass. Look at this schmoo.
Well,
we thought
I
the top was bad. Yeah, look, giant capacitor bank.
Whoa, look at the size of the bleed resistors.
Yeah. Yeah.
Before we tear them both completely apart, what are the odds that the short in the breaker would have caused those fuses to blow?
It would have had to have been a short between the breakers? Because one breaker is a single phase of power.
Yeah.
So it'd have to short across two phases for those to blow. And in theory, these should break if anything downstream of them fails.
But if that were true, then why would you need fuses anyway?
Because you're dealing with enough power that if something goes wrong, your board's gonna melt.
Right.
Your hands are small, right?
Oh yeah.
Cool.
That's my superpower.
I will need your small hands to get that exact connector out.
All right, cool. I think it's dead.
It looks like it's dead.
I call dead.
Oh yes.
Okay, we found another dead fuse, this time on the bottom board.
Huh. All the fuses blew.
The system works.
Oh yeah, okay. Actually, getting a close-up of the two fuses is probably interesting, because here's the not f***ed one.
Oh!
Yeah. Oh, there's your problem.
Hey, we found it. We were looking at the top.
Yeah, that's not good.
Okay.
That's very not good.
Okay, well, no, that's great. Now yeah. We know why it's dead.
Yeah.
You can actually see where some of the electricity was breaking through the solder mask around the edge of the trace.
Oh, cool.
And that would have electrolyzed the water. So this fuse probably tried to save everything else, but it was completely soaked in water and never stood a chance, unfortunately. Thank you for your service. I found some more hidden and sneaky shipping damage on one of the boards that got a little bit crunched.
Oh.
It doesn't look like it's damaged that'll impact anything, but I'll be taking a closer look at this board after we get it out.
Okay, I have bad news. I believe this is a different revision than the one that's in here. So yeah. We may need this board to work.
Yeah.
Like your IC is completely
That's
different from mine.
There's the crunch.
Oh, that might be fine.
Yeah, like it's probably fine.
That might just be a ground or something, right? I'm not taking everything out of here because we decided that we were gonna keep the receptacles and also...
This side is super mangled on this one.
Yeah, for the input. So I guess we just leave all of that.
Yeah.
Which is kind of convenient because it means we're not actually rewiring that much. So is this it?
Yeah, I think we just put it back together.
Okay, good luck, everybody. Now, under normal circumstances, I would absolutely look at something like this and I'd go, oh man, let's do a quick test boot of it, you know, on the bench, but we can't. We don't even have a way of connecting the top board to the bottom board without screwing the whole thing together anyway. Also, from a safety standpoint, this chassis protects us from, even if we're careful, accidentally touching something that we really don't want to touch.
Yeah, there were, I think, 700 or 600 volt caps under here. Looks like I'm now ready for board number the two.
No way.
Yeah.
I've got my breakers almost in. Dude, nice. This is going so fast.
Yeah.
We're gonna plug this whole thing back together. It's gonna turn right on. We're gonna be like, damn, we're really good at this.
And it was totally worth it.
You know, we've actually got a couple of videos coming soon on the economics of, you know, buying broken stuff on eBay and fixing them. We bought half a dozen CPUs. Mm. And then I think we bought a bunch of motherboards. Then we're gonna compare to the median US wage and see if we could make a living just like buying things on eBay and fixing them. This one was unintentional. This was more just, I really, 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 really didn't want to buy another one.
I don't know exactly why these are directional, but I do see what looks like a diode marker on them, which implies it's designed to go in a particular direction.
Oh.
Generally with these, when they break, they're high enough voltage that it'll maintain an arc even if the conductor has broken. So they're filled with glass or sand that acts to damp out the arc that's created.
Okay, here's your orientation.
Cool.
Gotta say, I kind of feel like I'm waiting for the other shoe to drop a little bit here on this project.
Same.
It's going too good. Okay, this cable was almost certainly supposed to be routed underneath, but it makes it, which means that's the last screw. What's your confidence level?
Honestly, pretty high.
Now, I have an idea.
Okay.
I was thinking we power it up with just the battery before actually plugging it into the wall.
Sure.
Okay.
Do you need help?
No.
You sure?
I'm used to having to carry around something heavy like this, you know?
With your tiny hands?
Yeah.
Squeaky noises in electronics.
Yay! BP volt out of range, UPS shutting off, battery
let,
pack,
let battery voltage pack out of range. Which is probably too low.
Okay.
Oh, It's probably shutting itself off
because
it's too low.
Too low.
Yeah.
Which
so
is
So with
fine.
A wall plug, it's probably fine.
Let's get the cover on.
Yeah.
So all I gotta do is slide her in. I was about to say that's the last thing that's broken. I forgot my son's gaming rig. It's like, she's working, but she's limping. Okay, nothing beeped or was disastrous. Here goes the plug. I hear the UPS, let's go have a look. Load not powered, emergency off. It says battery pack voltage out of range, but we measured the voltage at about 200. And on the top of the unit, it says nominal pack voltage is 180 volts. So that should be fine.
Yeah.
Dude, Tynan.
Oh, did we do a dumb?
Well, we didn't.
Oh no.
But I might have. See that little green RPO thing? It's supposed to be jumpered.
Oh yeah, it is. I know the thing.
I meant to put that back in.
Yep, that's important.
After painstakingly paying super careful attention to everything we did internally, I think we just were like, oh, we put it back together, let's go test it. And I think we might have just missed that jumper and that might be it.
All powered on already.
Okay, hold on, it's saying please wait right now.
Yeah, it worked.
Online mode, boom, we're in.
Oh, that was terrible.
That sucked. There. Yeah, let's go! Woo! She's on!
Load protected, online mode.
Okay, yeah, I'm plugging the PDU in.
Okay.
Okay, go for it.
Oh, it's alive.
Oh, yeah!
It's drawing the power.
Yeah, this right here. This is the face of a guy who just saved thousands of dollars. Ah, freaking awesome. Time to
Sick.
Get everything plugged back in. Probably the worst thing that I've been doing lately. No, it's not even this. Is the fact that the 240 volt device on the other end, which is the 115 inch TV, because it's China. I just plugged it into a 120 volt outlet and I was like, I don't know, maybe it's gonna be fine. My understanding is it does put additional strain on the power supply, but shouldn't kill it immediately. So I'm gonna be powering my TV properly now.
Properly.
Well, properly-ish.
You know, you can just re-terminate the plug onto the actual cable instead of jerry-rigging the cable to another cable, right?
Yeah, but this was convenient because I think the cable was already in the wall or something, I don't know.
Yeah, you can terminate it to the cable that was in the wall.
Yeah, I don't know. There was a reason I did it that way. I can't remember what it was.
Okay.
Boop, boop, boop. Boop, boop. And boop. 1,500 watts. No problem, baby. Efficiency 87%. I don't know if that's good, but it's good enough for me, and it's good enough to tell you.
Why would I be working if I could be driving Hennessy's brand new Velociraptor in Salt Lake City?
Shut up, Dennis.
Woo-hoo! Baja mode. Oh, that sounds crazy. Oh my God, did I just run over someone?
Now we have the chance to win this truck home from our sponsor, Rich. Look at their new Hennessy wallet. How beautiful. Oh, it's actually salty. If this is not to your tastes, how about this gold-plated Cybertruck?
And this is real gold. I'm sure you will get all the attention you've been dreaming of.
But Ridge, I'm more of a real gold digger. Oh shit, my wick.
Fine, you can take this bag of cash home with you instead.
From now till September 13, you can enter the contest with no purchase needed.
Or get more entries when you spend on the Ridge website. $1 equals one entry.
Just make sure you use our link in the description.
Dennis?
How did you get into the car?
I can't tell if I'm blessed or cursed, you know?
Both.
Like, the water, the random corrosion wouldn't have happened to someone who was blessed, right? But then someone who was cursed couldn't have possibly gotten a UPS of that caliber for $500.
And conveniently had someone on staff who knew how to rebuild it.
Well, yeah, that too. If you guys enjoyed this video, maybe go check out part one where the bulk of the diagnosis of the leak itself took place. Hey, do you want to see the fitting?
Yes.